Persuading. You thought it was going to be thunderstorms, didn't you?
Well,
you took some persuading.
I know.
And I thought, you'll kick yourself if you miss it, and it worked. So anyway, I phoned Phil and kind of badgered him, really badgered him into it. And then Phil went, well, we better have a car full. So he rang a few people as well. And we got Simon Bailey to come along as well, didn't we?
Two of them didn't
want to
go.
No.
I was working with them.
I think Barry was, where's Barry gone? You, no, you weren't. You were on holiday in Devon or Cornwall or somewhere. Paul Winterbottom, I think, had family commitments. Anyway, everybody said, no, you must be mad. So Phil and Simon and I set off really early one morning and went down to Malvern, which was Phil's recommendation. I was actually looking at another site just a few miles away, but Phil said, Malvern would work, let's do that. So we set off. And my weapon of choice for the day was my Fee Maestro, which is a B-rated harness, B-rated glider, and my advanced weightless harness, which I have to say is a brilliant combination, and I enjoy flying them. Anyway, so this was Malvern. Now, what we didn't know until we got there, myself and Phil and Simon, because we hadn't set our varios to tell us about restricted airspace above 7,000 feet, because in this country, why would you?
I think it's new.
And someone, someone twigged and said, do you think we better check for airspace? So we recalibrated our varios, and this popped up. That little red block is an FL-75. And as Phil said that his objective for the day was to break 10,000 feet, it gave us a problem. You had to fly half an hour to get out of it. So Phil said to me and Simon, you guys disappear off the site, I'll hang around on the site, just get as high as I can, you guys go and play around and I'll see you later on. Then we discovered this and Phil went, no, it's off, mate. All the game plans changed. I'm getting out of there and I'm hitting my 10,000 feet, didn't you? So,
well, I knew I could get back or get close.
So this is Malvern and there's like four takeoff areas on Malvern and we all went for the first one of them. And I have to be honest, to me, it felt horrible.
Good question. What was the launch direction that day?
It was an easterly wind, and it felt horrible. Kettle sings.
We went to the main one.
Yeah. I struggled to get my glider off the ground. You know when it's really windy and horrible, and you get your glider up and it just turns into a horseshoe and twists itself inside out. And that was me. That was the start of that day.
Well, you waited too long.
I did wait too long.
Half an hour early, we're fine.
Phil got off and started flying around, and Simon followed him, and they got into this thermal, and I'm still sat there, waiting for the right conditions, and some bloke in a advanced Omega X Alps thing to get out of my bloody way. I thought, with a glider like that, you should be off and enjoying yourself. I'm sat here with not many hours and a B-rated glider worrying about what's going to happen. I turned around and just below Phil and Simon, in the thermal that they were in, just to the left, there was a guy with his reserve out. And I thought, I didn't need to see that before taking off, really.
This guy, I was just sort of about 200 foot, and he was in front of me, and he went up, and I thought, he's in the thermal. I flew out towards this guy, I joined his thermal, he went behind me, and as I come round, I was like, he's gone. He disappeared, yeah. And I looked down, and I just saw the reserve opening.
What was the air like then?
It was rough.
It was horrible. It was horrible. Yeah. And there was a little gully between takeoff and where they were with this thermal. There was a gully. And in that gully, it was a mess. It was really unpleasant. Anyway, so those guys kept going, and I got off. This guy with the X-Alps got out of my way, and I got off. And this was my first flight. And that lasted 20 minutes, that flight. And I'm halfway through that flight, and I can't hear Phil on his radio. All I get when Phil's talking is... But I could hear Simon. And I'm lower than takeoff over the landing field, thinking, not a chance, no. Because the week before, I'd gone to Longmind with Jim, and we'd seen Jacob there, and Jacob had done his flight that he's going to talk about after this. And I'd bombed out at Wenlock Edge, and had like a 2-hour walk back afterwards, and stopped at a pub on the way, because it was the only thing that was going to put a smile on my face that day. Anyway, that was 1 week before this. So I'm hanging around just above takeoff thinking, not again, not again, not when Simon says they've already disappeared. So managed to get back to takeoff. It was 300 metres south of takeoff. There was another bit that looked like it was good for landing. What I didn't know was it was full of rabbit holes. And as I came in for a really fast landing, my right foot, which is full of titanium because of motorbike accidents when I was a reckless teenager, went straight down a rabbit hole. And the rest of my body didn't. The rest of my body kept going. So that was a moment of ouch. Anyway, I sat there for a moment whilst a woman appeared from behind a bush and said, "You've landed in my toilet area, do you mind?" And I was like, "Oh, terribly sorry, I'll try not to do it again." Gathered my thoughts and off I went. By this time, Simon and Phil were a good best part of an hour ahead of me, disappeared off from the site. Everybody else had either disappeared off from the site or they'd gone down to the landing field. And I was determined to try and make something of the day. Anyway, this was my second flight. 5.5 hours, 9,500 feet, just short of 9,500 feet. However, on three occasions in this flight, I was less than 1,200 feet above ground and had to save it. And I was kind of chuffed with myself that I did. I'll tell you a little bit about this flight in the next, I promise it won't take more than 10 minutes. I'll be less if you'll ring me up. So there we are. That was my day. I'm going to tell you about that in a minute. This was how my flight went. And it's down to you guys how fast I play this. Not that one. Come back from there. Yeah. I'll leave it at 32 times the speed. So, that's Malvern. The wind's coming from the right, which is the east. And away we go. This is my second flight.
Is it Shropshire way?
No. Yeah.
Worcester, isn't it?
Yeah, Worcester. Worcester.
Hereford. It's on board Hereford,
it's strange. So it's completely flat, but then the
there's just a ridge. Yeah. So. You get a good view off it. So there we are. Takeoff was 300 metres further north of where I am. I've decided to go where all the rabbits were. Anyway, off we went. And I'm floating around looking for something, and then all of a sudden, boom. So I'll leave it on 32 times, and I'm thinking, oh, this is the one. You know when you think, this is the one? Well, this was it. This was the one. And it took me up to 6,400 feet. Right. And I was on the radio going, "I'm after you, lads, I'm after you, I'm after you." He couldn't hear me. Simon could hear me, but didn't care because they were already an hour into the flight. I don't know if he could.
I could hear Phil from Parliament.
Yeah.
But really? You couldn't hear me.
So there we go. Now, hang on. Let me just pause it there for a sec. This is what you can see when you're flying away from Malvern. This was the view that I had. And I thought, right, where am I going to go? I'm going downwind, but where am I going to go? And what you suddenly start to realise is there's quite a few polytunnels. And polytunnels seem to work on a nice sunny day. So I thought, go for that. Anyway, we're off. And it's a big space. And by this time, I can see down to Bristol. I can see the estuary. And I'm thinking, bloody hell, that's quite a good view. Why am I losing so much height? Panic. This was the first time in the flight that I was losing loads of height and had to find something, and it dropped me down to just 1,200 feet above ground, which you'll see in, actually just after this thermal, you'll see if you plot the chart at the bottom, you'll watch me coming down, and I'm looking at the polytunnels thinking, I hope you're going to work for me. I hope you're going to work. I hope you're going to work.
Do you remember how much sink there was?
5 meters a second. Yeah.
And
I thought, that plastic, that's got to work. If that doesn't work. So by this time, I'm the best part of an hour into the flight. Now, what I didn't know at this point was my Vario linked, because I don't have it anymore, it linked into Live Track 24 automatically. And that's how my missus keeps an eye on where I am and what I'm doing when I'm off flying. What I didn't know was that Live Track 24 decided not to keep showing where I was. And an hour into a 5.5 hour flight, my missus thought I crashed at 38 kilometres an hour into a cherry farm. More about that later. So I caught one, and it was a nice one. This is in metres, I can't remember what it was in feet, but I had a big smile on my face at this time. Remember, I've not really done much outside of Lancashire. A little bit in Yorkshire, some in Cumbria, by the time I'd done this flight. So there we are, flying along. I can't make it go any faster than 32 times, so you'll just have to bear with it for a minute, but it'll be over in a few minutes. So I'm flying around thinking, well, I better figure out where I'm going next. And
when were you out of AFL?
Half an hour into the flight. Yeah. So
you're well out.
I'm well out of it now, and I'm quite happy with myself. And I'm tracking along, and now I started thinking, well, there's still no clouds. It was actually a pretty blue sky day, wasn't it, Phil? For a lot of it, it was a blue sky, yeah.
And we were in, like, me and Simon were in a grey area of cloud, which you must have got to.
I remember him saying, it's very weak lift. It's very weak, there's not a lot going on. He was a bit bothered about it.
Well, early on, the first hour were crap, and then it got banging line.
So I'm starting wandering around now. I'll show you the overall track log later, but I'm starting wandering around now. Actually, instead of looking at clouds, because there weren't any, I'm looking at the ground, thinking, shit, 5,000 feet up in the air, that's actually a bit worrying. I'm starting to think I'll have to land in a moment. $5,000 up. Anyway, I'm playing about.
Fields, didn't it, there?
Yeah, so there I am. This was the second time I got within 1,200 feet of the ground. I think I was 1,000 feet above the ground at this point, and I found another thermal, and you can see that it was going to be a nice one. But by this time, you see from the chart at the top, I'm still going kind of west. And now I've changed. Now, look at that. That's my direction of travel. Southeast. Now I'm going southeast. And at this point, I'm trying to find clouds and play around under clouds. And I'll show you. This is what playing around under the clouds was like at this point. And I'll try and find it where there's a glider. There's a speaker. The wind noise dies in a moment.
They're over to the south.
Talking about sailplanes that I've seen. I don't know if the rest of you do it, but I talk to myself while I'm flying. So I'm at 8,000 feet. There should be a sailplane in the right-hand side of the screen at any moment. I can't see it now, but anyway, it was there when I looked earlier.
The ground's dry. In front of Malvern's, It was all yellow, weren't it?
Yeah, it was. It was proper yellow.
Green bits here, but
there were fields that were still on fire. You can see the smoke coming up from fields that are on fire.
Do you think that the dryness affected the...
Stop
overdeveloping, you reckon?
No, the dryness would encourage it to overdevelop. I'm on the ground, you mean?
Yeah,
that would make it hotter, though. Although, I see what you mean, see what you're saying, but it
will
make it hotter.
So, I'm trying to play around under the clouds at this time and avoid sailplanes.
It's a lot drier than the River Valley, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
It was
I think it was the Sunday, yeah.
It was Sunday.
It's quite an inversion, or it looks like it's quite a lot of haze.
Yeah, it's quite murky. The visibility weren't great.
Anyway, this one took me... This was actually... I'd been in a thermal that I'll show you the readings on with a couple of photos. I didn't have my camera switched on for that. This started at 8,000 feet. And I put my camera on because I'd seen these sailplanes and I thought, oh, I want to try and catch them. Anyway, they were like 6,000 feet below me and they were about that big. They are on there, but you just can't see them on the screen. Anyway, I left that. I think I was...
Cold.
It wasn't that bad. No, it wasn't that bad. It wasn't that. It didn't feel that cold. I left there at 9,000 feet. I think I read it out, and I think the speaker should play it. But
35-40 degrees on the ground, weren't it?
Yeah, it was. It was really warm. Yeah.
The lights, one of the hottest days ever, weren't it?
So that.
There you go.
That's my Vario. It was like getting in an express lift. So I went into that at 8,000 feet and it was 6 meters a second for about 30 seconds.
8,600.
I'm not even turning around. I'm not even circling. I'm just under a cloud and it wants me.
Yahoo.
8,800.
I'm going up at 6 meters a second and I'm not even turning. I'm not trying. I'm actually thinking I better get to the edge of this cloud and be able to get away from it.
900.
He still looks a good way above you though.
Yeah, it was 1,000 feet above me.
Base is about 10,400 feet.
Nice, was it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Your Vario has fairly unenthusiastic sounding.
Yeah.
That's good.
I left that, I think between this cloud and the next cloud, I got to 9,400 feet. Anyway, we've seen enough of that, I think. I'll show you one where there was sailplanes. I think the sailplanes are like 30 seconds into this one.
BBC
is that the same one?
ITV, both shows. Hang on. Loads of thunderstorms in Wales and around that area. And when you look at the clouds, they got it wrong. There were some bigger clouds at one point. I remember thinking, oh, that's getting big. We've got to better keep an eye on the clouds. But then they dissipated a bit more.
RASP was bang on, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, for once, yeah.
Yeah, depending which parameters you use on RASP.
Yeah. You can hear the Vario there getting a little bit excited.
What are you doing there then?
What Vario do you use?
I just have a little bit. Oh, say again, Jim.
What's it doing there then?
What's it doing?
What's the rate of climb at that point?
6 meters. Yeah. That was a different thermal.
Yeah, it's pretty tame, isn't it?
So I've got it dumbed down a little bit because, like, whoever gets to, well, I don't get to 6 meters a second, so there's the sailplane. There were two of them, and I was thinking, oh, I didn't bring my flarm thing with me. Oh, well, I hope they can see me. Not a chance.
Is she
blind
and white as well?
Yeah. Got little red bits on it. No, black. Black, yeah. Got a white fin on the back of it. So yeah, there were loads of sailplanes about that day, weren't there?
Yeah.
And they were doing huge distances, like 600 miles and that. So I'm back up at 9,000 feet again. And that's what it looks like. That's what it felt like. Now, what I didn't realise till I'd got up to here and wanted to get on speed bar was just how damaged my ankle was from wedging it down a rabbit hole. And when I landed, I could barely walk, could I, to get back to the car. It was bloody painful. You can see there's a little bit of crosswind. But yeah, anyway. We don't need to see any more of that. That's life at 9,000 feet above the Malverns and heading towards Wales, the UK, yeah.
I dropped below 7 grand.
No, you didn't, I did.
For 2 or 3 hours,
yeah.
I never dropped below 7,000.
Three times I dropped to 1,000 feet.
I got above 9 grand. Well, I went down from like 9 to 10 grand.
Did you get your 10 grand, sir?
Yeah, I got my 10 grand there. I can't remember how many times I got above 9 grand. I wrote it in the storyboard, but I got above 9 grand. Me and Simon got above 9 grand about seven or eight times or something.
Yeah. So this was a thermal where I didn't have my camera switched on, and I wasn't switching it on when I was partway up the thermal because I was hanging on. Time recording says 2 hours 36 minutes in the bottom right corner, and I counted this because it does a step once every second, and 2 hours 38, it was actually 1 minute 45 seconds later, I'd gone from 6,220 feet to 8,241 feet. So I was in 6 meters a second for the best part of 2 minutes. And I knew about it. And it, oh yeah. It was dancing, yeah, it was dancing. I was hanging on. It was fun, but yeah. So anyway, back to the track log. We'll whiz through this quickly. Stop me when you've had enough. So by this time, this is where I'm trying to actually, let's just whiz through this lot. Oh, what have I done? Get rid of that. So there I am, flying around, up to 9,000 odd feet. And by this time, I'm trying to chase clouds.
In space.
I was in space. There we are. 9,000 feet odd above wherever I was. And at this point, I'm actually over the border with Wales. And I'm thinking, my grand idea originally, when I looked at what was happening with the weather, was to just go for North Wales. And some people kind of did. Some people went to the Welsh coast, some people went down south, and some people went to North Wales. And I foolishly made the decision, because I heard Simon on the radio.
They
did.
Some of them declared.
Yeah.
You could have had a little map for us.
I could have done, because you were in Snowdon. You were flying over Snowdon at the time with Nobby. Anyway, I didn't. I thought I'll stick with the team and turn for where we'd started from, which was a bad decision because, of course, then I was going into wind, which made it more interesting and a lot more challenging for finding thermals.
There aren't any wind high up, though.
Not high up. There wasn't a lot. So by this time, I'm tracking back, and I could see Shobham, which was the restricted airspace, but the restricted airspace, I think, goes to 3,500, maybe 4,000 feet. I was up at 9,000 feet, so I shouldn't have really cared, but I decided to fly around it anyway. So play about. There's Wales down there, those hills that you can see on the left-hand side. I'd gone over the Welsh border, saw a big sign saying, here be dragons, and thought, better turn back. So there we are. Flying back now towards the Malverns, bit more rising air. You can see all the hills there. It must have been kicking off like crazy over all those hills, but I didn't go for it. Kind of kicked myself sometimes. Now here, boom, it was getting late in the day. I actually took off, I think, at 1:30 in the afternoon, which was an hour after these guys had taken off.
You took off so early?
Yeah, took off at 1:30 for this flight. Remember, I had the other flight that was 20 minutes and fanning about, breaking my ankle and stuff like that. So it was getting hard, actually, at this stage to find thermals. Anyway, I'm back to 1,000 foot above ground at this point, and I'm a long way from home, and I got one or two little beep. And I thought, right, search about, get it. This thermal starts here. Let's see, where are we there? Count this with me. So that's my low point there, I think, at 1733. Yeah, 1732, 1733. That's the bottom of the thermal. I constantly was going up from 1733, 5:30 in the afternoon by this time. And I stopped gaining height. There wasn't a single point where I was losing height. And it was hard work for the first couple of thousand feet. I got back up to 8,000 feet and it was 1803. I was in one thermal gaining height constantly for 30 minutes. And it was hard work.
At that time of day as well.
At that time of day. So it was 6 o'clock by the time I peaked on that thermal. I was getting hungry, I must admit. This was the first time I'd ever opened my harness, reached for some food, and I'd eaten while I was flying. It was the first time I'd ever done that. And I needed it.
Are you turning the same way the whole time as well?
Uh,
swapped.
Yes, I looked at the stats afterwards and I turned to the right 80% of the time. Yeah, and actually I was using my broken, well, not wasn't broken, but it'd been broken years ago, and it's full of titanium, this ankle, and I limp on it anyway. But I was using, that's my speed bar ankle, or my speed bar foot, and I was turning to the right, so I was putting all my pressure through my right leg, stupidly, for 5 hours. Anyway, so here we are. This was my last thermal. Got me back up to over 8,000 feet. It was about 8,500 feet, something like that. 2,400 metres, whatever that works out at. And I thought, right, crack on now. This is it. Slightly into wind. It was only about 10 kilometres an hour. 17 kilometre final glide, I had. 17 kilometre final glide.
Was that to go back to the Malvern?
Back towards Malvern Hills, yeah. So I couldn't see the Malvern Hills because it was a bit hazy by this time. Yeah. I was looking at my compass and thinking that's the bearing I need to be on.
You couldn't see it.
I couldn't see the Malverns from where I was because I was 30k away. Yeah. So I couldn't see it, just looking at it, thinking it'll be a hill that appears over there somewhere eventually. Anyway, I'm losing height again. And I got to the point where, where am I at now? Coming down, let's play that. And I thought, I'm not likely to find anything else at this time. And I was right, I didn't. So I spotted a little village. And at the side of this village is the poshest school I've ever seen, apart from Stonyhurst. And they had a pristine, absolutely pristine cricket pitch. And I thought, that'll do. There were a few kids playing tennis in the tennis courts. The school's got tennis courts, and there was a cricket pitch, and they're all like that, looking at me, coming down. And I landed on, I don't know what they call it, the actual patch right in the middle of the cricket pitch. I landed smack bang in the middle between where the wickets would be. And it was a perfect landing, and I was well chuffed. And I got straight on the phone to Simon and said, have you guys gone home? Because I've just landed. And you'd landed like an hour and a half or so earlier, more than that probably.
Yeah.
And I thought, bloody hell, it's a long walk home from here if the guys have already set off without me. And the first thing Simon said to me was, have you phoned your wife? I said, no, I phoned you, mate. He said, well, you better phone your wife. Why is that? Well, she thinks she crashed into a cherry farm 4.5 hours ago. And she's been desperately searching for people on Facebook that might know where you are. And she found my wife, Linda. So my wife rang Linda, Simon's wife, and said, my fella's out flying with your fella today. Have you any idea what's going on? So, of course, Linda called Simon, who had landed 2 hours before me. And Simon was like, oh, no, we left him on site like a year ago or whatever. So, of course, my wife's in full panic mode by this time, looking for life insurance policies in the desk and all sorts. So I'm straight on the phone to my missus, who's in tears, asking me why I've been picking cherries. Anyway, there we go. So that was good. Anyway, so I phoned Simon and I said, this is where I am. And he said, oh, you're just up the road. He said, I got a lift back for the car. Because none of the three of us made it back to Malvern Hills and back to the landing field, did we? So we all fell short. And we all got in the car. And we were like three little giggling schoolgirls. Honestly, we were like little giggling schoolgirls. We were all so buzzing off what a fantastic day it had been. And I'm looking at Fly Sky High, thinking, where's my stats, let's have a look. And I hadn't actually gone for distance, and I looked, and Fly Sky High just went 100 kilometres. And I thought, ooh, I've cracked it. And it wasn't 100 kilometres from A to B. It was 100 kilometres on the it wasn't a triangle, because I didn't close the triangle. But what I did do was that. So, yeah.
I drew. What does that look like?
I thought, if you're going to draw something in the sky, you see these pilots that draw things in the sky over California and that, don't you? So I thought, well, I'd better do my own in slow, you know, take 5.5 hours to do it, but there it is. So Malvern's on the bottom right, right round Shobham, across the border of Wales, most of the way back, 6 metres a second climbs, 5 metres a second descents, 17 kilometre final glide, and the biggest smile on my face I've ever had. And yeah, 5 hours 32, and I was hungry. And do you know what? We didn't stop for a pint on the way back.
Oh,
I know. We talked about it, didn't we? We talked about it, and we didn't stop for a pint on the way back. So it was a long drive. I don't think we got home. I think you dropped me off at home after 11 o'clock at night. Yeah, it was after 11 at night. Anyway, that was my 100-kilometre flight from what some people have called Tall Sunday on the 14th of August last year. That was your warm-up act. Now we'll get on with the professionals.
Was there a UK record that day? Does anyone know?
I think
he went for it.
Sorry?
No.
Was it not?
No. He applied for it.
I broke the altitude game.
I tell you what it was.
GPS. I've not even contacted John Stevenson. I keep thinking I'll email him, but I'm pretty sure altitude gain would be done by pressure.
Yeah.
And on pressure, I've not beat it. I was just short of the altitude gain record. That,
on altitude gain,
Greg
looking
Steele
at pressure.
Did it about 10, 15, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And I was like about, I don't know, 30 foot less. But on GPS, I'm about 100 foot more than what he did.
Right.
And I read about it. Apparently, like, pressure, when you get like above, the higher you get, the more inaccurate pressure gets. And it reaches low. So I got to about 10,000, nearly 10,000, I think it was something like 10,070, 10,370 feet on my GPS, but I was about 300 foot lower on my pressure.
Right.
But the GPS is the actual accurate one, isn't it?
Yeah.
I didn't know till afterwards, and he told me afterwards, and when I looked at my pressure readings, I was 800 foot below the record, because it's on height gain, isn't it, from takeoff to maximum height. And because I'd already had a 20 minute flight and landed lower down and gone for a second flight, I took off a couple of hundred feet lower down, so I was 800 feet short of breaking the record. How crazy would that have been?
Someone got higher than us from Bullerange that day.
Tim Pentry.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah,
Tim
he got
Pentry
a little bit
did.
Higher, but the record, well, I don't know, they don't do an altitude record, they do a height gain record. But our height gain, or my height gain, was more than Tim Pentreeve's, because Malvern's is only about 900 foot, where Bullerange is like almost 2 grand, isn't it?
Yeah.
So I like kicked his ass on the actual height gain. But yeah, I don't think we got the record, because I'm pretty sure it's done on pressure.
You got... You got very close to it. I got within 800 feet of it.
John Stevenson, but I've not bothered him.
Get it in. Get that record down.
I don't. Well, I'm pretty sure he's done pressure.
That's brilliant. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
A day before the flight that Francis and Fuller just talked about, and it was during a probably 2.5 week period, which, with a summer heat wave and just epic flying weather, the guys at the top of the league, like Jake Herbert, for example, the Dales pilot, who was second in the league this year, all of his flights were within this 2 week period in this top six. It was an amazing period. So what I thought I'd do is go through sort of how this day came about, how I planned it, and then walk through it a little bit. So planning, so the 2 days before, the 4th and the 5th, I was at work watching other people flying on the internet, and they were really good days. It was very hot and dry, it was during a heat wave, but you see Jake there on the 4th did a declared 142 flight from Selsey in northwesterly winds, and again the day after, so Tim Pentreef, who doesn't upload to the XC League unless he flies 200 kilometres, but yeah, he did over 200 from Selsey again on the 5th. So, and the 6th had a very good forecast as well. And that was Saturday, so I was off work then, so I could go. So the way I look at the weather, this is basically the initial look I do before I go into detail, because stars are not everything. You can have 5-star days that are absolutely rubbish, either clouded over or just thunderstorm. But some 5-star days are very good. So you can see here, we've got the wind curving around, and the important thing at this 11 o'clock point, oh, there we go, cursor. So The main thing I was looking at here was the wind to determine what site to go for. So it's west-northwest, but in the Peak District you can see it's quite a bit windier. So showing 10 to 16 knots in places near Sheffield, because I was deciding between Bradwell and the Long Mynd, which are two very good cross-country sites in west-northwest, northwest conditions. So Bradwell had a risk of being blown out. The Long Mynd, it was much lighter, so it probably wouldn't be blown out. And it also had a better star rating earlier in the day. And 1 o'clock, you see it's truly epic across, or it's at least 5 stars across most of the country. Wind hasn't changed too much. You can see it's got this curve coming down from sort of west-northwest down to a northerly. But that sort of changes through the day, and as you follow along your line, it changes to more of just a west-northwest.
It's almost too light to go downwind, isn't it, in a way?
Yeah, it was. We were half considering triangles, but when we got to the site, there was a decent breeze. So, and then 6 o'clock. So I've zoomed in here, so you can see Henley is where you've got this sort of blob here, which are sometimes accurate with RASP, sometimes not. But that seems a logical place to go, and also from an airspace perspective, because you've got Heathrow Airport just there in London. Henley's under 2.5 grand, so that was a good place to aim for, really. So the site, like I was saying, a choice between Long Mynd and Bradwell. Long Mynd had better early RASP with fairly light winds, but with lighter winds comes lower average speed for distance attempts. Bradwell later thermals, but faster with a stronger wind. And I chose the Mynd based on stars and less chance of being blown out, and as did quite a few of the Dales pilots. So another thing that I looked at, so this was only at the height of the day, but this is a CU cloud base, quite useful on RASP, and it's basically showing there's nothing for most of the route. Over the sort of, you'll see in the photos how dry it is on this side of the country, but over Wales there are some clouds, but...
And was it blue when you were flying after that?
Yes.
So raspberry, right?
But we had, I mean, compared to what we've just heard, it sounds like scraping the trees, really, by 6,000 feet. But on most good cross-country days, that's what you can expect in Britain.
Just go back to one slide. Mm-hmm. Like, loads of people don't realise that's showing blue. Mm-hmm. Do most of you realise that?
Yeah, so here you see clouds, so like that orange there conveys to 6,000 feet there.
So, but where there's nothing, no colours at all, there's a blue sky, there's no cumulus clouds.
Yeah.
But lots of people don't seem to get that.
Blue days can often strike fear into many cross-country pilots, but I've actually had a lot of very good days on blue days, especially this year when it's so dry. So never give up, even if it's looking like it's blue out ahead of you. So yeah, good firmling height. So we discussed the task. So I'm in a group with some really good pilots from the Dales who seem to be the most active cross-country club at the moment. It used to be Pennine when Phil and his mates were doing a lot of travelling. At the moment, doesn't seem that many Pennine pilots, they always make fun of me because they're saying I'm the only Pennine pilot who travels. But happily they appear to have taken me under their wing a bit. So they've got a really good active group. So we discussed the task here. So basically that's the line straight from the Mynd to Henley, so that's the Declare. But we've got this wall of this, so this is Bryce Norton's CTR and these two ATZs here, which we want to go around really, because although you can go over ATZs, and I have done it, it's not something I tend to plan on, because if you end up down there really low, then you're stuck.
Although you're going straight over Didcot at the end, aren't you?
Yeah, so by doing it this way, that's the route although we didn't set that as a task, because we purely set a straight line task, that was the route we had planned. So we go north of the wall. Here, careful, is the 4,500 foot airspace, which is here, and then it steps down as you get towards Henley. You can, yes, but you have to hit all the turn points. So I don't know if it would have been slightly more points because it's more distance going around the edge of the triangle, but I tend to just do straight declares. It gives me more options, I feel. So yeah, so that was the task we set. Whoops.
And you always plan to go higher and come round?
Yes. So if you haven't been to Long Mynd, go. It's a brilliant gliding site. Read the site guides. There's a small sights fee and stuff, but it's worth it. It's a huge long ridge.
Even longer than Long Ridge.
Yeah. Takes west-northwest through to west-southwest. It's about 1,400 feet high, so it's not huge. The only downside from my perspective is that it's really busy, and you've got, so there's a gliding airfield on there, you've got loads of these bloody hang gliders because it's top drivable. But to be honest, there's so much space, I've never really had a problem, but it does get busy, especially around the launch area. It's a brilliant site. Go there. For
people travel a long way to get there, don't they? It's not being you, everybody will be a lot.
Yeah, exactly. From Preston, where I live, it's about 2.5 hours to get there, but it's well worth it. I went there 6 times this year, I think. It's a terrific site. For cross-country flying, you don't really want the straight west because you go straight into Birmingham airspace. Malvern's is a bit better for that. Wind direction. You want it either west-northwest, like we had on this day, or west-southwest, because you can go north of Birmingham airspace, and I believe that's where the site records is, that direction for the Mynd.
Is it?
Yeah, someone, it's quite an old one, 2004, Kai Coleman, landed near Cambridge.
Oh, sorry, I thought you said west-southwest.
Yeah, so in west-southwest wind, so going north of the airspace, and there's sort of like
a... You won't land at Cambridge in a west-southwest.
Yeah, you can do, because if you go round, it's initial west-southwest, but presumably it came round more westerly.
It went over Birmingham. It went that way.
Yeah, I've done it. I've done part of that before.
I remember that flight.
But yeah, also nearby is the Lawley, which is quite useful if it's more off to the north. And in fact, that has a bigger site record than the Long Mynd, and you guys done some huge flights from there, haven't you?
We got to Poole from there.
Yeah, the south coast. So that's, it's a great area for flying from west southwest through to northwest. So the team of us that we had, some very good pilots, a mix of wings, so a few guys on the hot two liners. And some of us on that, so I was on a Delta 4, which is C wing, but to be honest, for cross country flying in the UK, it doesn't really make much difference on downwinders, the wing. But, and in terms of across the route, it was mainly Jake, Richard, Pete, and myself who flew together. The other ones got separated. So we got to the launch, and it looks epic. It's always great when you turn up to launch and it's looking like that. At this point we had clouds here, and it's relatively green as well on this side of the country, but you'll see how that changes. But I was very excited, so I got ready and got, I was the first of our crew up, and it's great when you're first up, because you take off, get in the thermal, look back, and then you see 20 pairs of eyes just staring at you. and then at some point they'll trigger, and then all start, you'll see gliders are coming up. So I like to take off early. So step by step through the flight from the photos I've taken, and I'll show you the times and sort of what's going on. So I took off at 10:44, and conditions were lovely. Initially we were capped to about 3,000 feet, so not really enough to go over the back there because there's quite a lot of dead area behind there. And so I just flew about for a bit, waited for the rest of the guys. And then we got up and away by 11:14, so nice early start. So early start's my big thing, really. I really like to get away early, because if you get away early and you can stay up, then you can get longer because you've got more time in the air. Or you bomb out. But I think it's worth the risk.
Yeah.
So this is just over the back of the Mynd. So you can see some of the guys up ahead there. So I can't tell who it is because the picture's not great.
That's well,
not
quite edge with all trees, isn't it?
Yeah. So you can still see it's still fairly green here. Quite a few brown fields for this side of the country, but and we've got clouds as well, which is nice. So we're heading towards that one because it looks good. So this is half an hour later. So we're 14k in. It wasn't too bad really initially. Sometimes it can be tricky over the back. And that there is called Clee Hill, and that was the first point we got lowish, 2,400 feet. It was probably about 1,500 feet over ground, so it wasn't too low. But it was the point where you start thinking, okay, I really need to climb now. So the weather this day was amazing. It was by far the best day that I've flown in the UK in terms of weather.
Not making this any easier for me.
You can see it's really green here.
That's about where I fell out of the sky.
So after that sort of lowish save, so 37 kilometres in, so you might be able to see it. So it's to the right there, it's in the haze, but you can see the Morverns, which Francis was talking about, and starting to get a bit browner too. So this flight was probably the flight where I actually worked out how to do team flying a lot better. Before this, I've mainly flown on my own. Even though I've gone to the hill with other people, I've always ended up on my own, either lagging behind or just out in front when I've just left the hill on my own. But this flight, I think basically for team flying to work, especially when you're in such accomplished companies, the guys that I was flying with, you just got to be quite aggressive and be prepared to lead out. So I spent a good hour where I was leading out and actually ahead of them, and they were just on the radio, oh, where's the next thermal, Jacob? So it's worth trying. It will go wrong sometimes and you'll bum out, but I think it's worth doing that, and that way you're less likely to fall behind. That's my attitude. Some people say, no, don't lead out, it's easier to follow. But I think it's good to be fairly independent, because then if you end up on your own, it's not a problem because you're used to it. You see now it's getting more brown and brown, and we're just past Worcester at this point. Yeah, now on this side of the country. So it's gone blue, you can see the inversion, and we didn't see a cloud after this, or a cumulus cloud after this anyway, and it basically just looked like this the whole way. It was. It wasn't that bizarre, because I've flown in Lincolnshire the week before and it was very similar. But for Britain, yeah, it looks like Spain almost, doesn't it?
Spain, yeah.
So at this point, we've got 100k, which is always a nice point to get through. I think this was my sixth 100 kilometre of my career, if it's a career. I can't work out what airfield that is, because it looks like a military airfield, but I don't think it can be Bryce Norton based on where we are, so I'm not sure what airfield. It was big anyway. And this is just before we had to do that right turn, and we're quite lucky because the wind turned around with us. Otherwise it could have been a little more tricky. But to be honest, it wasn't a very strong wind day. But you see here you've got Pete in the red and Jake in the blue there. Richard somewhere nearby as well, but yeah, been airborne for coming up, yeah, just under 6 hours at this point. So
did you fly over the 18th head or around it?
We went round it in the end, because we didn't have a lot to go off, and because we were high most of the time, we weren't following ground sources, so we just went our planned route. This is quite a nice picture. It was at this point where it started to get a bit tricky, so I stopped taking photos after this, I think. But you can see you've got Richard here, and then you see just about seeing the distance, Pete and Jake, if I do that, I think. So Pete and Jake in the thermal, but it basically got really, really mincy. I don't actually know if it was the day turning off? Because when we got to goal, it was absolutely booming. So I don't know if we were just being careful and hesitant because we were starting to, we were 152 in and we were starting to believe that goal was a possibility. But yeah, anyway, we spent a long time in very light thermals and then we'd been high the whole way, and then you can see in that distance, you see that line where it goes from brown to green there? That's the point where we got low, when we'd flown for like 6 hours over perfectly landable terrain and we got low over a forest. It's bloody typical. And we needed one more climb and that was it. So hence, I didn't actually take any pictures in that period, but you can see here, so this was the point there, that's that line there which shows the forest. It doesn't look quite as big on that picture, but basically you couldn't really land anywhere there. But happily, we worked together and we saw this bird and got in this the lightest climb ever. And it made me think back to flying in the evenings of pilot, trying to work the lightest of light thermals. And that practice paid off there, really, because it was a very light thermal, but got enough to get glide to goal.
Did you have anything to eat, Jacob?
No, I didn't.
Just Francis has sandwiches.
No, my flights are more economy class.
Toilet? Do you do anything?
No, toilet stops. I held it in for just under 8 hours.
Wow.
Because when you get older,
I'm sure I've seen films strapping a tube to
it. I used to do that as well, 8 hours.
So you can see this is Henley on Thames. I didn't know it was Henley on Thames because Richard had set the task. And basically when I'm cross-country flying, I have no idea where I am with respect to the grounds. I know exactly where I am with respect to the airspace, but no idea what's going on below me. So I didn't even know that was the Thames. I just thought, oh, there's a big city over there and a big white thing, which turned out to be Heathrow and London.
So that's southwest London, is it?
Yeah, it's just off. If she's got Heathrow Airport, it's just off to the
west.
Yeah, there's a full map up afterwards. But yeah, so we've got to go. And at this point, it's just chilled, really, just gliding in. You see, they've got these sort of flags on. I don't know why they've got flags made up by bushes, but that's quite cool to see. Anyway, I don't usually like selfies, but I did there. Gosh, what a mess. And we landed in this field, sort of, it's that field there, right next to the river. And there were some very, very confused people, some very confused posh people, actually. He said, oh, where have you come from? Shropshire. They said, what, Shropshire? yeah, you can see Richard there. Jake landed in a different field. Pete Darwood landed just before the unlandable bit because he was getting tired. And yeah, that's the thing about flying with these guys. After 6 hours of flying, Richard came on the radio. And Richard's usually very focused on the radio, whereas I'm doing a David Attenborough commentary of the world, really, when I'm flying. He's like, I've got a two up here. Oh, now it's 2.5 up, very focused, very clear on what he's going to do. He came on the radio and said, rather sheepishly, and said, Jacob, can we start turning left, please? I said, why? Because I can't feel my arm. So we turned left for the end of the flight. I don't know why we turned right so much, but...
it's the right thing to do.
But yeah, Henley's a rather nice place if you want to go and visit somewhere. We didn't stay there long, though. So some stats. So declared 173 kilometres, which is 216 points, if you care about that. The main thing for me was it achieved my goal of getting 100 miles in a straight line. And the main reason I had that goal is because I told my grandparents in the years prior, oh, I flew 100 kilometres by paragliding. They said, oh, how far is that? I said, 80 miles. They said, oh, that's nearly 100 miles. I thought, so now I've proudly told them I've done 100 miles, which is good. As a turn point flight, it's 181 if you include the turn that we did. Max altitude, shouldn't really have included that stat today because I'm losing very much on that, probably about half of what these guys got. The total climb during the flight was just under 54,000 feet, so that's quite cool, I think. Not at the same time, obviously, otherwise I'll be dead. So it was myself, Jake and Richard, we made the goal. Pete landed because he chose to, like he would have done if he wanted to. The thing for me is that the average speed was actually quite low. So I've had cross-country flights where I've had 30 kilometers per hour average speed. On windy days, you can get more than that, but it starts to get, it can become too windy, I think. Like, there are some guys who've done crazy flights in really strong winds and done massive distances, to be fair to them. But I'm not sure if that's something I'd be comfortable doing. But 23 kilometers per hour means I've got more in me. If I get a slightly faster day or a little bit more wind and then fly for the same amount of time, then you can get more. So that's the flight with the TARS, and the red line shows where it went. And you can see the altitude graph really, well, yeah, we basically didn't get very low the whole flight. It was only towards the end that was the tricky part. And that was that lowish save that I talked about. But basically, it almost looks more like a hang glider tracer. It was just a very, very, very good day. So the retrieve was really amazing. So Pete Morris, I think he's another Dales chap, isn't he?
Yeah.
So he bombed quite early, and then he went back to the hill and got Rob Cruikshank's van, who was flying but sort of behind us. He picked up Rob. I think Rob had done about 140. Then came all the way to Henley and got Pete's and Rosie Darwood on the way and took us all back to the Mynd. We landed and 20 minutes later we were in a car on the way back. Which meant we got back to the Mynd. Richard's let me stay in his palace. Richard Meat's got a massive motorhome, which is nicer than my house. that's not an exaggeration. And he let me stay in it, so that was great. So we got back in quite reasonable time, really, and got to bed to do more the next day. But on the Saturday, we didn't actually win the day. So Bradwell, as I discussed earlier, it wasn't blown out, as is often the case, because it's not a massive hill. So Gary Stenhouse did 200K, and I was really happy that he did that. He's still probably talking about it somewhere. I saw him in Cumbria last week, and he's still talking about it. So yeah, they had a harder time earlier. Like the RASP was saying, it was showing weaker thermals in the early part of the day in the Peak District. So they quite low trace, but then it looked epic and they got to 6,000-7,000 feet. So Richard Carter and Gary Stenhouse did declared 200s from there. Then we were next. So if points are your thing, then we perhaps made a poor decision, but to be honest, I don't care. Some people get really competitive about the cross-country flying, which is absolutely fine. But for me, it's more about the experiences you have. I have been competitive about it in the past, but nowadays I'm thinking, well, actually, I was looking through these photos and remembering exactly what was going on at that point. And it's just the fun of it, really.
Yeah.
David Attenborough commentary is the way to go. And then the very next day, when it comes up, myself and Pete Darwood, we had to get back to work the next day. So we declared 100K to Moreton-on-Marsh, so somewhere we passed the previous day. And I did the task actually on this, what I thought was an airfield, but it's actually a fire training place. When I got there, I noticed there were a couple of Tornado fighter jets there. That there is a fake motorway, and they use it for training fire response crews. That was the goal that Pete Darwood came in scraping in. And if he'd landed there, he might not have been able to get out because the place was locked up, but he did find the climb. It was actually a much harder day the next day. So Jim and Francis joined us and were quite unlucky at the start because we all got low, but some of us managed to scrape out basically. And I got really low the climb before getting the glide to goal as well. And the other Dales guides did 160 kilometres from the Mynd declared, which I would have got, I think, if I'd gone for that, because we went a different direction. But work has been the story of my year, really. But yeah, very happy. Amazing weekend.
Yeah.
Any questions?
I should just say,
how do you do it?
Jim and I were on mint before he took off on this flight this day, the day after he'd done his 173 kilometre or whatever. And I went to Jacob and I said, any tips for flying off long winded? He said, oh, just enjoy yourself. And I said, where's goal for you today? And he said, oh, Henley on Thames. He said, I'm only declaring 100 because I've got to get back to work. So he can declare 100K knowing he can go twice as far, but he'll cash his chips in at 100K because he's got to get back to work. And he thinks nothing of doing 100K knowing he could have got twice as far.
Does your employer know this?
Yeah. I'm trying to get promotion out of it.
The rest of us go, 100K would be amazing. He just goes, yeah, I'm only doing 100 today.
For me, with cross-country flying, the thing that I've noticed, having done it for 3 or 4 years now, is that there seems to be a lot of elitism about it, thinking and almost like sanctifying people, say, oh, he's doing it just because they're them and stuff. But it's not, really. Some people do tend to make good decisions more often than others, but that's largely experience, or perhaps they've done a lot of work behind it, so research the weather and stuff. So I think really, you just got to get your head down, not worry about what other people, and just do the best you can and enjoy it. And then if you do that, then you're winning. It doesn't matter how far it is. I've had shorter flights, which are just as fun as that one. Yeah, it's fun at the end of the day. Well, that's why I do it. You can get competitive with it if you want to, which is another good avenue and a good motivator. But yeah, I just like getting high up and seeing the world, really.
Don't make it the be all and end all, because it took me 24 years or something to do 100K.
Considerably, the gliders and stuff are much, much better these days, aren't they?
Yeah.
So that's a massive performance multiplier.
Yeah, absolutely. I couldn't have done it on the old wings at all.
Question. If you do declare, say, 100K, and you get to go, but you're like ridiculously high, can you carry on flying but still submit your track over the 100K and get the 100K points? Or do you have to land at where you declare your...
Yeah, so what you can do, if I go back... Alright, that's going to take a while. But what you can do, basically, if you get from your start, if you declare 100K, start cylinder to end cylinder,
yeah.
Remember for a declare, it takes the amount you have to go through the cylinder. But if you look at a declared triangle, for example, the deductions will be 2.4 kilometres, I think. So if you want to do a declared 100, do 102-ish K. But if you fly that, you get go from your start, get your 100K, instrument goes bing, woohoo.
Yeah.
Oh wait, I'm at 6,000 feet, and there's no airspace downwind of me, and I've still got loads of day left. Just keep going.
Yeah.
So if you land after that, and you don't get, say you get, so 100K declared would get you 125 points. Say you land at 116 kilometres, you can still submit it as a declared and then get your 125 points.
Right.
If you go beyond 125 kilometres, then just submit it as a turn point flight, and then you'll get 150, say, if you've gone 150. So yeah, if you're in the position where you've got to go, like my previous PB from Bradwell, I declared Bradwell to Lincoln, made it to Lincoln. I was high and it was snowing. Downwind, it looked sunny, so I thought, oh, I'll go over there, and then flew to the coast. So, and that turned out to be better than the declare. But then the next thing I say is just declare the maximum distance possible, because that's much more fun.
It's just one of those that I've like, I've flown a task and I'm like, do I need to land now? And I've always just like ended up landing and, you know, do something else, but I always wondered about distance.
Yeah, for downwind, it's basically go as far as you want. For triangles, obviously, because you end up where you started, then you're sort of committed to your task. With triangles, choosing what size you declare is probably a bit more harder, whereas for downwind, I just do the biggest one possible.
Yeah.
I went to the Brits at Grand Bernard this year, which
we recommend going to the British. It seems like people might think it's elitist because, you know, it's got the world's best pilots in it. Brits won the world that year. But it's, once you're down to like 80th place, 90th place, it's just no other sports car. Like, so I think we went to Azure in Spain to recommend. John Bernard is with our 2 points to meet.
Sorry,
and
I see
that most people
might
be
used to down there.
Just tuck it in your pocket there, actually.
Cheers. So, if you're going to Annecy, it might be worth a trip out to Grand-Bernard. It's got a ski lift. And the tasks tended to be, one big task was to get back to Annecy and back. And then, is that the RV, I think? That,
yeah, that's
the RV. We try and fly that most days. But it was for the area, it was quite a low cloud base, but that made for good photos. And photos are, like having fun, like Jacob said, photos are a priority, I think. For, I will sacrifice a flight to go, you know, lose attention and to get a photo. I think some good photos.
I think it's a real good point that I think when you've been flying for quite a few years, it's like photos that bring the memories back.
Mm. Why am I showing this? Oh yeah, I didn't have any big flights this year, but I thought this has just got some pretty photos out of this. I shouldn't be more ambitious really. This was I'll put the date on that one. Oh, this is in, yeah, the 8th of the 8th, yeah. Sammy Skygod, does anyone know? He's back. He's back flying again. Yeah, I was flying with him on this flight.
Well, he was, last time I spoke to him.
He's a body, big bodybuilder. You'd know him if you saw him. He's humongous. he stopped for a long time, but he's back now, yeah.
Has he moved back up there?
Yeah, I think that was it, yeah.
He was living in Essex, wasn't he? I saw him on, last time I saw him was on the
north. So that's behind Bradwell. I think Bradwell, Derbyshire's best place for purple in the world, so that's just the purple.
Of
yeah,
some good stuff of Pilot this year.
Yeah, yeah.
We did. Really purple.
But be able to get high during purple season as well, you need a bit of luck there to go. And that's Sammy Skygod on the Stannage Edge, which I always love flying over for, because it used to climb there.
What's
now?
He flying now?
He's still on Niviuk
Ice
Peak, is it? Yeah.
I don't know, I guess.
An older one. That's, if I don't clean my sensor for about a month, that's the dust.
I thought it was a reserve.
Yeah. Somebody had a reserve.
Yeah, that's. Changing lenses on takeoff get well, that's what gets you. Yeah, landing in Castleton. I think it was like 3 good days in a row in Bradwell. I think Brian tried a triangle, and the Castleton was one of his points. But we've just been following that street there for a while. What's that? Got another day.
It's on this side.
Where?
I think it's in the never zone now.
Ah, got it. Yeah, I've got it. Bradwell. Oh, yeah. I just want a good day on
Pendle, yeah.
Yeah, because I like this one because it's that's you, Jacob. Hands, oh, cool. Hands behind your head.
Wow.
That's a crop. That's a crop. if we crop in on Jacob,
I always
just
that.
Just like that.
Oh, it's all so easy.
Yeah, it's a.
Can you send me that?
Yeah.
Nothing.
Feet up in the brains.
Yeah.
I think I remember this day. It was a really frustrating day because we were on the
deck. Yeah, loads of people on the deck, and I'm like, I felt like if I went like left base, I'd just be on the deck because everyone was struggling to get off. But we'd got a good sight, just really.
So that day was, one of those, I was scratching around, I thought I was going to go down, and it just went to the end, and then.
Yeah, and I think two of us went to you, and we're the ones that managed to get higher. But like, got easier once you were halfway to base, kind of thing, didn't it?
Yeah.
Is that 15 mil again?
Yeah, that is a
really stalk, not, so you can't really tell there's a hill, can you?
That is a stitch. That's probably five photos. So I put it in portrait, lock off the exposure, and it's got five around like that. And Lightroom's really good at stitching. I used to be really labour intensive to stitch in Photoshop, but now it's just one left click in Lightroom. Those five photos, and it just stitches it all for you.
I'm assuming you didn't carry that camera around X-Lake, so.
I did.
Did it?
Yeah.
Well, that's a solid effort, that is.
It's, yeah, I used to have a small camera, but then you take it, when you get a really good shot, you're like, what would that look like on the big camera? So I just thought, I'm always taking the big camera from now on. It's just like an average day at Parlick, but it's really weird conditions for Parlick, just like super easy in every direction, and no one expected it. And Parlick bottom right there. But if anyone had been determined on that day, you could have done sort of bridge to Longridge. I think Googly did go out to Longridge that day, probably to Preston and back again, but just, what time of year was it?
Yeah, when was
it? It was the second of the sixth. But it's still loads of fun, like, you feel like, because you're away from the hill for a while, you feel like you're XC, but you can always see the hill sort of thing.
Yeah.
So I got the XC buzz out of that without going away from the hill that day.
Yeah, I like the taste of that.
Yeah, I like.
Yeah.
What direction was it? Southwest.
Very light. I think we're on the everyone's on the south face there. I think.
Like, yeah. Southerly drift.
Yeah. And sailplanes are just like, buzzing everywhere as well. Yeah, that's just my collection of decent photos from this year.
That's John. Everyone's going to be flying home with you next year. Let's try and get.
Yeah.
You can recreate your old desktop background.
Yeah. Have you got that one of Pendle, or would that just be a nightmare to find?
I've just got a selection of 4 days. Yeah. I just did that. And yeah, does anyone know that film? No, yeah, it's everywhere, everything everywhere all at once. You've got to see it. And I've got some videos from the year before, if anyone's bothered, or do someone else want to go?
Those are brilliant. Has anybody got any pictures and things
you
want to show?
Crack a video.
I can show you some near misses if you want.
Just had a helicopter.
Oh, these are not very compressed, so your laptop might struggle playing these.
It's really slow, that laptop, but it seems to manage videos okay.
Alright. That's an easterly wind this day. So.
Is that
I'm sure Tom maybe wants to arrive just to get those climbs off the back of Cleverley and trick up by the river, heading for the east face of one which is so blue.
Yeah, skirt of blue, like you're saying.
Sorry, the birds around, so I'm just going to have my local knowledge of how now the ground rises from the left to right up to Longridge. There's the odd seagull around here, so if things have got promising, so I put traverse his face in desperation and luckily triggers in textbook modification. This looks like an Icarus Draft 22 in white and red. It's flying from one paragraph inside to another, which isn't normal around it. I think it's Andy Archer, the site officer. Which proves to be correct after a check on Facebook. What are the chances of me meeting him?
Clear of conflict.
Anyway, don't try to get too distracted. I need to use this climb right to the end on this on a blue day like this. I follow this ridge long and hope something comes off the back of it. Just following the ground here, nothing else to do. And we get lucky here. So half up on a day like this, we'll take that. Let's see how far we can get with it. This is where John Murphy spots me from his back garden. We have a quick chat and then I get back to looking forward, trying to come up with some sort of plan. There isn't many features to go for. I don't want to go left over the little towns of Longbridge because that's going to mess me up later if it warps into the space and get to my goal. I'm on a head in a straight line, but then I stumble into the zero. Heck the zero. Well, heck the zero.
That is my internal voice when I'm trying to find it. Yeah, I do, but ovals.
Great. This zero has turned into some quite nasty signal, so it's time to...
That's cool.
Some time gone into this.
Yeah, it's fast bar on the Alpina.
That is awesome.
Why haven't I seen this on YouTube?
That's a Pina 3 if you want another speed bar. Too long this cut. I should have really edited this bit. Really annoys me. Just that feeling of when you've been in sync on bar for ages and you hear your vario again for the first time in ages. You're like, oh my God, thank God.
Something at the end of this sync. I was hoping it'd be a sugar point. After the strip of holders in Barton, we're often to really drop a gear down now and find a inner John Murphy to mid-south this. I thought the day could be over here.
Yeah, I was scared of the blue, and I was having to think, well, you know, John Murphy's on so many mincing flights that...
He did it last week.
Yeah.
I spot someone granddad in the field. Quite handy, showing me the slowly slowing direction down there.
Good eye, sir.
Wonder who we had.
Is it easier on the day?
I got past Longbridge, made that sinky gap over the M6. We're currently just on our way out of Inskip. We're trying to stay with the climb as long as possible, but it's tempting to dive goal, trying not to do anything. The instrument's showing about 20 to 1 now. That's optimistic, but in the end, as you see, the climb here slows out, and we're forced to go for it. Nice parallel flight with the F-55.
Go west, go west, go west, this is where Oh no, there's a bit from Yannick, isn't there? Yep. So Yannick was at Blackpool train station. Yeah.
Did he check the
pendulum? He went from Parlick, yeah. And he said he struggled to get down. He was like, from...
You hit Seabreeze?
Is it Convergence? But Yannick, I didn't. Yannick found Convergence and I didn't. It's like 10 minutes after. He came right from Freckleton. Right, not end kind of way. Yeah.
That's flipping awesome.
Yeah.
You landed in a, what were the wind direction when you landed?
Nearly near wind. Yeah. I think I was in. So like, I was like, under the convergence.
You.
So
you were later than you.
We're both on the same train, so it's pretty similar. Yeah.
Well, maybe that close to cost, Seabreeze might have been 10 minutes later, mine.
Yeah. I feel like I was more, maybe Seabreeze convergence was just above my head, and if I got a bit higher, I would have tried ping or something. But.
It's usually like, and you're very close to the motorway where you were climbing anyways, where I caught it quite a few times there.
Well, it's an easterly wind, so I think it, does it not push it? Oh yeah, it would be over the motorway sometimes, yeah.
Yeah, I've had it a few times over the motorway.
But you weren't that big, looking at how far you got.
Like. Yeah, I've just chuffed in the blue because I was like, you shouldn't be scared of the blue, like you're saying, but I was just like, every thermal felt lucky to find, sort of thing.
That was a brilliant flight, and superb video.
Yeah, I enjoyed the edit, yeah. I spent half the time on the sound on that one than I did on the actual editing.
That was good fun, John.
Yeah, well, the 360 cameras are just made for paragliders. Yeah. They really are. Yeah, you've been doing a lot, haven't you?
But they
give you too many choices in the edit, so it just takes you for
it. Use the village people, by the way. That's a story you should tell them. I'm a bit more worried.
I nearly went with the Pet Shop Boys edit, but I stuck with the original in the end. Yeah.
Excellent, well done, John.
Yeah, good.